Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup by People's Dispatch, where we bring you major news developments from across the world. Our headlines: anti-racism protests intensify across the US following another video of a black man being shot by the police. Jordan releases teachers' union leaders on bail. Mass mobilizations take place in Colombia, calling for an end to massacres. And the Caribbean community demands justice and reparations for slavery. Nearly 3 months after the murder of George Floyd, protests have intensified once again following the release of another video of a police shooting yet another black man. The incident took place on Sunday evening in the town of Kenosha in Wisconsin. A graphic video of police officers shooting a black man went viral. The man was identified as Jacob Blake. In the graphic video taken from across the street, the officer shooting Blake was seen firing several rounds into his back while holding him inside the car. At the time of the incident, Blake's wife and children were also present on the scene, according to a statement by the attorney representing the family. State Governor Tony Evers also added that Blake is currently receiving medical care after being flown to hospital. Within hours of the shooting, hundreds of protesters gathered near the scene of the crime and held a demonstration condemning the violence. The demonstration took place despite the Kenosha County Administration having declared an overnight curfew and a state of emergency. Family friends said that Blake is out of surgery but remains in intensive care. Details about what transpired are still unclear, with only limited information being given out. According to reports, the police stated at the time of the incident that they were responding to a domestic violence call in the area, but no details were given about the caller or the call itself. Meanwhile, in the city of Portland, a right-wing pro-Trump group, Proud Boys, attacked anti-racist demonstrators on Saturday. According to the police account, which does not mention Proud Boys, the violence was a result of clashes between opposing groups of demonstrators outside the Justice Center in the city. But several protesters and eyewitness accounts have declared that Proud Boys instigated fights at several places. The Justice Center houses the contentious juvenile detention center and has been among the constant site of daily demonstrations since May. Residents and protesters have been strongly demanding the closure of the detention center in nearly 3 months of protest. The police again declared a riot by Sunday, which was followed by a forcible crowd dispersal against the protesters, residents, and even media persons in downtown Portland. The city's demonstrations were recently in the national spotlight after a controversial deployment of federal forces by the Donald Trump administration and reports of unlawful detention by them. In our next story, we go to Jordan, where 13 elected board members of the Jordanian Teacher Syndicate were released on bail after completing the mandatory one-month detention period on Sunday. The top leaders of the country's largest teachers' union, including its acting head Nasir Nawarasreh, were arrested on July 25th. The arrest and detention of the union leaders last month was part of a wider crackdown by the Jordanian authorities on the teachers' union and thousands of associated teachers all over the country. The union was protesting the government's failure to keep its promise from last year to increase the salaries of teachers along with better working conditions. Teachers' union organized one of Jordan's biggest strikes yet in September 2019. The strike, which lasted over a month, was organized in order to put pressure on the government to agree to their demands. The strike ended after the government agreed to meet the union's demands. However, in April this year, the government went back on its promise. It cited the lack of funds and the economic slowdown due to COVID-19 as the reason. Following this, the government banned the union for 2 years. Security forces also raided several of the union's offices and branches around the country, arresting top leaders. The government also issued a gag order on the media from reporting on the issue, as well as on other developments and investigations into the leaders. In our next story, Colombian youth organizations organized mass mobilizations across the country in response to the frequent massacres and recent surge in the killing of youth and social leaders. The protests took place in the backdrop of 3 fresh massacres that took place in the country over 24 hours. Marchers carried signs saying, "We are not combatants, we are not drug traffickers, and we are not criminals, we are just young people." Protesters also brought forward the issue of the resurgence of paramilitarism, police abuse and brutality, and violations by the military against civilian rights. The normalization of the violence throughout the country as the government of Iván Duque has failed to uphold the 2016 peace accords was also raised. Pot banging protests took place on Saturday in cities such as Cali and Bogota. Meanwhile, Iván Duque has been accused of presenting highly dubious figures on collective homicides or massacres and making the argument that Colombia has made gains in lowering the rates of such violent crimes. The number of massacres in Colombia up till August as of this year has nearly surpassed the figures of 2019. And finally, citing years of slavery and racism perpetrated by European and North American countries, the Caribbean community CARICOM demanded justice for its member countries. The demand was made in the context of the International Day for the Remembrance of Slave Trade and its Abolition. CARICOM, through its Reparation Commission, advocated for the compensation for damages caused to indigenous and Afro-descendant communities of the Caribbean during the colonization period. A public apology was demanded from countries such as the United Kingdom, France, Spain, Portugal, Netherlands, Sweden, and Denmark for the damage caused due to the Caribbean people during slavery. In July, CARICOM Chairman and Prime Minister of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, Dr. Ralph Gonsalves, issued a statement marking Emancipation Day, stating that he urged all in CARICOM to focus on reparations for the enslavement of Africans on Emancipation Day 2020. Gonsalves also urged governments in the region to develop better programs to educate people about the importance of slavery reparations in the Caribbean. The Prime Minister of Barbados, Mia Mottley, highlighted that slavery reparations have more to do with justice than material compensation. That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with major news developments from across the world. Until then, keep watching People's Dispatch. De pie cantante, vamos a triunfar.